Welcome. We are excited to get underway, and thank you all for taking time to be here. I'm Larry Frank.
I'm Heather Stewart.
And we're going to start off. And basically, this event was a long time in coming, and I'll just make a few comments to see if I can find my... where do I go here to do this? The mouse?
Yeah, make sure this one is chosen.
It's actually, something happened. Something got shifted in my talk. There it is.
Maybe we didn't save the changes.
Okay, so we're just going to start off and do some introductions, and actually we're going to go around the room and have everybody say their name so people at least by face have an idea who you are. We're both with I'm with the University of British Columbia, and Heather is both.
Yeah, I'm with Simon Fraser University. I have a dual position between UBC and SFU.
And basically, we schemed this together. So Heather and I started working on this some time ago, and along with our wonderful collaborator Susan Kirkland, who's over here. And Betsy Elizabeth Christensen, but she spells it in a very complex way. and there are many ways to spell that. So the four of us are really been working together every week, talking for well over half a year, figuring out how to pull this event together to achieve some specific outcomes. And we're going to go through that. But before we do, I want to introduce. Our staff and those who help to do this will point them out as they arrive and are here. But Josh Van Loon, who I think is maybe downstairs trying to direct you to come upstairs, certainly helped a lot. He's a research manager in the lab. And Carly, who's outside right now welcoming people, had a lot to do with organization. And Neil, role, but Neil's a planning student, and Leonard and Shay, you may have heard a lot from Shay as you were getting your materials, so we want to recognize them. They worked really hard. And so I'm going to let Heather go through the purpose, and we'll kind of talk about the motivation as well. Just a couple introductory slides, and then we'll open it up for next steps.
So you can see, even for a small event, it takes a village to pull it off. There's many of you in the room who would agree to that. So the purpose of this workshop and this gathering is really to advance a research agenda to conduct longitudinal causal evaluation of environmental impacts on health and well-being in middle and late adulthood. The motivation really is neighborhood environmental determinants of health may be stronger for older adults who spend more time close to home in retirement years and who also have decreased mobility. So, and you will see over the course of the next couple of days that the Canadian Longitudinal Study on Aging, which is a new major strategic initiative of CIHR, is a theme that's going to be running through the 2 days, and we're hoping that you'll see its value and potential in expediting and facilitating this emerging research agenda. So just a couple of housekeeping items for you. The breakout sessions that are happening this afternoon, there's two of the sessions will be in this room, or two of the breakout groups will meet in this room, sort of on opposite ends. Another group will meet in room 7027, I believe, also on this floor. It's a smaller room, and Josh and Carly will help direct you to that room after lunch, okay? And then there's another meeting room down on the third floor, room 3100. Again, if you're assigned to that group, we will help you find that room down on the third floor. The washrooms are... you go outside the auditorium and turn right. It's just a short walk down the hallway past the lockers. You can't miss them, really. Okay, and feel free to get up and go as you need to go, etc. It's an informal gathering.
Perfect.
Good.
Thank you, Heather. So a little bit, I'm going to turn it over and just have everybody introduce themselves. Just say your affiliation and perhaps just a one or two few sentences why you wanted to come and be here. this has been a long time in coming and thinking about working with my colleagues, Abby King, who's here, Brian Salins, and others. We've been working together for a good while as well in the U.S., looking at healthy aging and built environment. And in Canada, we have the opportunity with the Canadian Longitudinal Study on Aging. Heather is the local lead in data collection. Susan's the PI, co-PI, of the CLSA, which is an enormous undertaking. I think 50,000 Canadians over 20 years being tracked. So it opens up a lot of doors. And thinking about from all that we've been learning in the U.S. and then with the opportunity, the CLSA kind of came together in a real opportunity. CIHR funded this. The Institute on Aging needs to be recognized. They funded this workshop. We submitted the proposal for the workshop out of 150. The proposal for this workshop ranked number one. So they gave us a grant to do a capacity building workshop. So we're here with a purpose, as to learn from each other, and then we're recording everything. And we have, there'll be 45 so total delegates, so just part of that is here today, but in the afternoon we'll have other people who are coming. We'll be working on agenda building around thematic areas, which is important. There's really huge new opportunities. Mike Kobor, who's here in the back, works on epigenetics, and there's a whole emerging area around genome mapping and ability to look at our adaptation. I won't say too much because I know I'll probably get it wrong. But Mike's going to talk about it, and he knows a lot about it. So anyways, there's a lot of opportunity, and so we see the aging population as one most in need. So with that, I just wanted to mention the funders, of course, and Institute on Aging. So I'm going to turn it over, and maybe we'll just start in the front and just go across. Well, maybe Gloria goes first because she's in the very front. And we'll start with you, your affiliation, a couple words, and then everybody will have a chance to speak, and then we'll go into the program.
Gloria, introduce yourself.
Gloria Gutman, Professor Emerita, Gerontology, SFU, and I'm here wearing a number of hats. I'm also on the advisory board for the CIHR Institute of Aging, and was there when age-friendly cities was first discussed by WHO.
Susan Kirkland from Dalhousie University. Very pleased to be here. I'm in the Department of Community Health and Epidemiology at Dalhousie, and I'm an epidemiologist by training, and have spent the last, at least, a lot of years, where are we? The last 14 years working on the CLSA.
Elizabeth Christensen, or Betsy, University of Ottawa. I lead a large study of neighborhoods and health, and the built environment and health in Ottawa, called the Ottawa Neighborhood Study. And I'm here because I see the amazing potential in the CLSA.
I'm Daniela Gasic. I'm just finishing my PhD at Simon Fraser University, and I just got a position at University of Edinburgh in Scotland, where I'm moving pretty soon. And I'm here definitely to learn from more experienced colleagues here, and then because, as Betsy said, like a huge potential for the study, and just to see for potential collaborations in the future, because I plan to continue in the built environment and health in Edinburgh too.
My name is April Lewis. I'm the BC representative for CARP, which was the Canadian Association of Retired Persons, but has been rebranded a new vision of aging for Canada. We have 60 volunteer chapters across the country. We're the largest advocacy group for healthy aging for all Canadians as we age.
I'm Carolyn Gauté. I'm at the University of British Columbia. I direct a cancer prevention center there, and so I'm interested in looking at this population in terms of the potential for prevention. I think it's been relatively neglected in emphasis on kids, which of course no one can disagree with, but I think there are other potentials as well, and I'm looking forward to learning a lot more from all of you.
Morning everyone, my name's Eric Fox. I'm a GIS specialist for Urban Design for Health. I work closely with Larry, and mostly on developing walkability surfaces, built environment measures, scenario planning across multiple age cohorts, including seniors, and I'm here to learn what other colleagues in the field are working on.
I'm Rick Kosterman. I'm with the Social Development Research Group at the University of Washington, and I've actually been working a bit with Larry and his team in helping us figure out how to look at the built environment as part of a longitudinal study that we have tracking a Seattle-based cohort. They're they're now 39, so they're not quite aged, but they're getting there. Hopefully we can keep the funding going and all this will be relevant to us in the future. But happy to be here in any case.
I'm Suzanne Bell. I'm a planner with TransLink, the Regional Transportation Authority here in Metro Vancouver. I'm here because there obviously is a direct link between good land use principles and the ability to serve seniors with transit. And, you know, as the first baby boomers turned 65 in 2011, we start to see a shift in the demographics on our transit system between commuters and being able to serve senior population as well. So it's very important to me to learn ways that we can help with mobility issues and communication.
Hi, I'm Leslie Gaudette. I'm here representing the Council of Senior Citizens Organizations of British Columbia, which represents over 100,000 seniors living across British Columbia. My colleague Catherine Jameson will be joining us shortly, and she's actually giving you a presentation. In my other life, before I became a senior, I'm an epidemiologist. I worked with Cancer Statistics for Canada. I had my epidemiology degree from the University of Ottawa, but I started off at Simon Fraser with a biochemistry degree. So I'm really excited to be here and doing some research work in my retiring years.
I'm Dylan Passmore with the City of Vancouver, recently started in the Active Transportation Group. And so there are obvious connections between active transportation, healthy living, and that's become a big focus of our group. Myself and Douglas are pretty involved in this, those connections, and also connecting up to some broader city policies, such as the Healthy City Strategy and whatnot. So I'm really looking forward to hearing what you all have to say.
Douglas Scott, I'm also with Active Transportation at City of Vancouver. I was the lead in developing the Comox-Helmkin Greenway a couple of years ago, continuing to work with Larry on studies of how people are using it. Also working with Heather McKay's group at the Center for Hip Health and Mobility on studies about seniors' use of the facility and how the infrastructure is changing their lives. And my other role at the city is working on pedestrian coordination through rezonings and developments. So I have some influence on how those developments are improving the built environment for seniors and for just everyone in the City of Vancouver.
Eva Donna, planner by profession, also management consultant and psychologist, which nibbles in gerontology for years. And I'm a member of Seniors Advisory Committee appointed by City Council. It's my second term, and we work very closely with the Transportation Department, so I know the fellows here. And we represent the issues brought in by seniors to the City Council so they can pass the motions and things can go forward, like aging society and aging moving in the direction of being accepted by World Health Organization at age-friendly city.
Hi, I'm Binay. I'm a first-year PhD student at UBC, and Larry is my supervisor. And my research interest is in built environment and health, and I want to focus on longitudinal study, how built environment might impact the behavior, and how that behavior will result in different health outcomes. So since one of the main focus of this workshop is the longitudinal study, I'm interested in knowing what are the current research going in this field. That's what I'm thinking.
Eric Douglas, I'm also an advisee of Professor Frank, new PhD student, and I'm very interested in the effects of the built environment on the environment itself and sustainability and also on health, so I'm interested in seeing how that relates.
Hi, my name is Adam Gavetti. I'm a graduate planning student at UBC, and my research looks at public engagement through gaming and seeing how residents could transform their streets into greenways or active transportation corridors that fits their needs. Some of my work includes the Point Break Cornwall Greenway, where we engaged over 300 youth in collaborative gaming, and we came up with their design preferences.
I'm Kristen Day. I'm at New York University, and my background is in planning and design for walkability, research on that. And my current research is on these issues in China, which is fascinating because they're building so much, so it's a chance to try to do some things differently. But long ago, and completely separately, I did a lot of research on design for older adults. So when I got this invitation, it was the first time in my life to bring them together. So I'm excited about that opportunity.
I'm Brian Sales. I'm at the University of Washington. I'm actually in the Department of Pediatrics, so I'm on the other side of the age spectrum, but I do a fair amount of built environment work across the lifespan. So I'm interested to hear about this longitudinal study as well as if we contribute some of the evidence that we've worked on.
I'm Abby King. I'm professor of health research and policy and medicine at Stanford University School of Medicine, that sunny, very dry place just south of us. I have envy of all the water, and secretly between you and me, I sort of hope it rains. Sort of feel what that's like again. So I'm a behavioral scientist by training, and our goal is generally to change things. So we like to develop interventions that could be applicable across populations, and obviously built environments are a huge part of this environment behavior interface. And we particularly like to reach into underserved populations who aren't able to perhaps benefit as much as others, at least today or currently. I was pleased to hear about some of the gaming things, because actually in another part of my lab we do that with seniors. I'm not going to be presenting too much of that today, but I'd love to have sidebar conversations about that. Thanks.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Philip Chapman. I'm a planner with the District of North Vancouver, which is a rapidly aging suburban population. And I've been involved most recently in the development of our official community plan, which has identified four growth areas to turn villages and town centers, to create villages and town centers. And I serve as council liaison to our seniors population and those with disabilities.
Hi, my name's Maureen Levitt, and I'm a broadcast consultant, and I work for Super Channel right, for the last 7 years on their programming. And but I have an ongoing interest in seniors' issues. My family helped bring in the Gentle Care program some years ago that has since been dismantled. And I've spent about 4 years in care with both parents. And so I'm really interested in looking at design and support within care. That's my focus. And for 6 years, I did a show called Let's Sing Again, aimed at seniors, and we got over 12,000 handwritten letters.
And my name is Glynis Whiting, and I'm a filmmaker. I first met Larry when I introduced him for interviewed him for a Nature Things documentary called Weight of the World, looking at the relationship between the relationship between our contemporary society and obesity, and specifically with Larry looking at the built environment and obesity, and read his wonderful book at that time, and have since then wanted to look at doing more on the subject in as a filmmaker, and Larry graciously allowed me to attend so that I can just hear what everybody has to say on the subject. So thank you for letting me.
Careful though, Glynis writes murder mystery.
Okay, that's
what's
going on.
She does.
And I should say that Larry graciously allowed me to attend. I'm not very pleased.
We're happy
to
have
here.
You here. You may end up doing a documentary on healthy aging.
Okay, well, I don't write murder mysteries. So good morning, everyone. My name is Trevor Dummer. I'm Associate Professor in the School of Population and Public Health here at UBC, and just joined Carolyn's Cancer Prevention Centre from Dalhousie University, actually, in Halifax. I'm a health geographer, and although most of my research has not been in older people, it's in about health promotion, disease prevention, and health geography, obviously the built environment and everything that geography is, how that can lead towards disease prevention, in particular related to cancer. So I'm interested to sort of find out various things that are going on here and the potential for the CLSA and connections.
I'm Michael Kova from UBC as well in the Department of Medical Genetics and the Center for Molecular Medicine and Therapeutics at the Children's Hospital. Our research focus is on epigenetics, as you will hear just before lunch. What we're most interested in is the aspects by which social and physical environments can get under the skin to affect the health and behavior across the lifespan. And I've been privileged to be part of the CLSA, thanks to Susan and others as the co-director of the Genetics and Epigenetics Center.
This is Dale Bracewell. Dale is has laryngitis. And so I actually had laryngitis, never fully recovered, and his doctor has recommended that he not speak
it's 3 weeks
for the next 4 months. Dale likes to speak.
For those of you who have met him in the past, so this is a bit challenging. So there's probably a lot of writing, exchanging of notes, Dale is the manager of active transportation at the City of Vancouver. Dale was also the director of Olympic transportation during the Winter Olympics here for the City of Vancouver. Has been in transportation for a long time and is moving the dial on active transportation for all of us quite rapidly. So, yes. He's going to be a great part of this day, you'll just have to bear with the silence.
I think we can handle it. Okay, so we'll get going with our program. We're about 15 minutes behind, but that's okay because we have some buffer room in Larry's time slot. So Susan, do you want to come on up, please? So Susan's already introduced herself, and I think we can say that had it not been for her and the hard work of her two co-PIs, Christina Wolfson at McGill and Parminderina at McMaster, we probably wouldn't be here. And Susan, I don't know if you mentioned that you're also the lead for the Dalhousie Data Collection site as well, and the CADI site. Yeah, so come on up.
Hi, Heather.
All the bios and everything are
safe. This program is best in this area. Right there. Great. Thanks. Well, I have to say it's a true pleasure to be here. Vancouver is my hometown, and it's a lovely place to come. But I'm very, very excited to be part of this entire gathering and also to be working with Larry on the built environment. And there are many, many opportunities, I think, to really explore and expand what we know through the CLSA, quite possibly. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to tell you some stuff you already know. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about how we came to design the CLSA and what our thinking was as we were designing it. And then I'm going to tell you a little bit about the CLSA itself and how I think we might be able to use it in this context. And then Heather, who's speaking after me, will go into a lot more detail about the actual measures in the CLSA so that we can get into some detail. So this is the part that I'm pretty sure you all know, that Canadians are living longer and they're making up a greater part of the population. And so whereas in early 2000, it was seniors made up 1 in 8 Canadians, they now make up a much greater percentage. And by 2025, it will be 1 in 5 our seniors. And I think you also know that the baby boomers are aging, and starting in 2011, the baby boomers started to turn 65, and that will occur until 2031. And they really have been sort of a glut all the way along in the system. And they will continue right the way through to the end. And you can be sure the baby boomers have had an impact. They really have had a cohort effect all the way through their lives. And they've had huge impact on things like schools and school systems, health and health systems. And they will continue to impact things in terms of aging and housing and healthcare and social care and all of those kinds of things. So I think that that's important. I do not want to glom all seniors as one. I think this is something that's very dangerous. But just in terms of a cohort, I think it's important to recognize that seniors today and possibly going into the future are generally better off financially than seniors have been in the past. They tend to be better educated. They live more years in retirement. They have huge expectations around health and healthcare that earlier generations simply didn't have. And they also have the cultural values, at least in North America, of autonomy and self-reliance and independence. Those things are very, very important. And as a consequence, they really do want to age in their communities. But there are also challenges that they face. They face health challenges. There are all kinds of things to deal with in terms of sensory losses and those kinds of things. So it has huge implications for the healthcare system, the social system, and also for community planning. So this is data from CHMS, and if you look at it, it's looking at the proportion of Canadians who meet the physical activity guidelines. CHMS is the Canadian Health Measures Survey. And what I've circled for you here is older adults, and you can see about 15% of the population meet the physical activity guidelines. Not that the rest of the population isn't doing so great, so it's not really fair to pick on seniors, but I think it's important to note. This is another really, really, really big health issue that's starting to come to the forefront now is sedentary behavior. And again, if you look, seniors are no different than anybody else. So those dark bars there, and seniors are in the last bar in both columns. There's males and females there. This is number of sedentary hours in a day. And as Canadians, we average an average of 10 waking hours being sedentary, which is huge. In terms of health markers, this is looking at obesity. And if you look at the red bars, it is 2004. If you look at the blue bars, it was 1978-79. So there's quite a span there in time. But what you can see is that the proportion of Canadians in every age group who are considered obese has dramatically increased over that 25 to 30-year period. And then this just looks at health outcomes. And so again, this is the proportion of Canadians who report one or more diseases by age group. And so if you look at the bars, the black bar, and let's just focus on the 80 plus group for the moment, the white bar is the proportion of people who have who report no chronic diseases. The light blue bar is those who report one disease. The gray bar is those who report two diseases. The dark blue bar is those who report three, and the dark bar is those who report four or more. So you can see that in the older population, this is a very big issue. Now, as an epidemiologist, I can't pass up the opportunity to talk about something that comes from the epidemiology field, and it's understanding the health both of individuals but also of populations. And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to rectangularize the survival curve. So what it means basically for both individuals or for populations is that we want to keep everybody healthy until a ripe old age, and then they can just drop dead. So that, you know, that just rectangularizes the survival curve. And we want to do that not just for individuals, but we also want to do it for populations. What we do is it's called compression of morbidity. So we want to compress the amount of morbidity that people have right into that last phase of their life. And again, this is something that we want to do for individuals and for societies. But what we have to think about, and when James Freese was working on that, he was thinking that there was a fixed lifespan. And there probably is a fixed lifespan, but if you look at average life expectancy, it has continued to increase by about 2 years per decade and hasn't stopped yet. So right now in Canada, if you are a woman at birth, you can expect to live your average is 83.3 years. And if you're a man, it's 78.8. But what's really interesting is that if you live to the age of 65 and you get through everything before that, your life expectancy is actually a lot longer. So if you make it to 65, you can expect to live another 21.6 years if you're a woman, and another 18.5 years if you're a man, which takes you up to 86.6 and 83.5 respectively. And so what that means is that the challenge for us really is to be able to live long and well, because it's not enough just to live long if you have no quality of life. And so from a research perspective, from a policy perspective, we really have to make the shift from thinking about, you know, not just morbidity or not just mortality, but really thinking about what is it that impacts people's quality of life. And that's what we have to be looking at in terms of our outcomes. So we really need to focus our thinking or shift our thinking so that we're looking at, you know, what about function? What about ability and disability? What about well-being? What about autonomy? What about the things that matter to people? And this is sort of leads into the concept of healthy aging. And I bring out the health part because I really think that we do, when we talk about healthy aging, it's not just about physical aging. It's about understanding that there are psychological aspects of aging, there are economic aspects of aging, there are social aspects of aging, all of which have a huge impact. And it's not just the absence of disease that is relevant. And if we think about the concept of aging, I think it's also important that we don't just equate aging with the aged, and that we think about aging as a process, and it's a process that occurs over the life course. And so it doesn't mean that, you know, when you turn 65, you become old. I don't think anybody in the room thinks that. But we do kind of, as a society, have that sort of value. But it's really about understanding that aging is a process that occurs over the lifespan, and what happens to you in earlier points in your life is actually critically important to you as you become a senior. And really the notion that aging is multidimensional, that there are various aspects that we need to consider. And when I look at the age-friendly cities work that has been done, it's really interesting because all of the things that are important for age-friendly cities are also the things that are important for both individuals and populations as well. And it really is a very nice model for where we need to be moving. So I just want to tell you a little bit about the CLSA. This is an initiative that has been on the books for a very long time. When the Canadian Institutes for Health Research were first formulated in 2000, they identified that they were very interested in supporting two cohorts, two longitudinal cohorts. One was a birth cohort and one was an aging cohort. And those sort of were pie in the sky kind of ideas. They just knew that they wanted to support them. Nothing was really in place to support them. And what was interesting is that, in fact, the CLSA has come to fruition, whereas the birth cohort to date has not come to fruition. So it was there were two very different processes in terms of the way that they unfolded. But the scientific director of the Institute of Aging at that time was Régent Hébert. And what he did is he held a workshop with researchers from across the country, from a wide variety of disciplines, from biology to genetics to psychology to clinical medicine, and said, is there an appetite for a study like this in this country? And the resounding answer was yes. And so what he did is he released a request for proposals right at that time. And the request was to design the protocol. And interestingly, myself and my two colleagues, Parminder Reyna from McMaster and Christina Wolfson from McGill, came together and decided that we would develop the study. And as we developed it, we pulled in, because obviously you can't be an expert in every area. And as we designed it, we pulled in people who were experts across the country. And it became very clear that the original intent was that we would just hand over this protocol to CIHR and they would do whatever they thought that they would do with it. But in fact, it became an investigator-driven initiative. So we kind of sort of span this fence because it definitely is a strategic initiative by CIHR. CIHR, you know, asked us to originally develop it, but it has become something that is very central to what we do. So I think the key tenets are that it is multidisciplinary and it's it is the largest study of its kind to date in Canada. But when we were actually sort of formulating what the protocol might look like and how we would think about it, one of the first things we did is we did a review of international studies on aging. And it was very, very interesting because the majority of them really did focus only on people who were over the age of 65. And which is fine in one way, except for that we're really interested in looking at the process of aging. And the other thing is that when you start at 65, people are going to die a lot more quickly. And so what happened is they would have all of these questions that they would want to answer, but they simply could not answer them because, you know, they didn't have a large enough study to start with and people died off. And so you didn't have the power to answer these questions, especially when they're multidisciplinary. But one of the other things that we found is that there were studies that had really good information on the social aspects of aging. So they talk about social participation and isolation and loneliness and those kinds of things, or economics, but they would have no information on health. And then vice versa, there would be studies that had really, really, really good information on health, but no other, not the other breadth. And then on the other end of the spectrum was genetic studies, who all they had was genetic information. They didn't have any of the other sort of very rich phenotyping information that we would want. And it was interesting because at this time there were also these very large biobanks being developed. And so I'm sure you're familiar with the UK biobank, for example, where they're following 500,000 people. But basically what they have is they have blood and urine from them, and that gives you rich, rich, rich genetic information. But then they have very, very weak information on other aspects of the person. And they're following them longitudinally because they're going to link to various data sets, but they just don't have the breadth of information to really clearly look at gene-environment interactions. And I think that we do really want to be able to do this and to, especially in relation to understanding complex diseases. And I'm not going to talk about this a lot because I know Mike is going to talk about it, but it's very clear that it's not genes alone or it's not environment alone. It's the interplay. But it's not simply the interplay. It's about gene expression. And that is what is so interesting. And what is fascinating is that we know now that it goes both ways. We know that social environments can influence the expression of genes. And that's something that I think a study like the CLSA is absolutely set up to study. And so that's what we started out with. We understood that we wanted to be able to look at the aging process. We didn't want to confine ourselves to people who are age 65 and older. That we really wanted to understand we didn't want to think about diseases as, you know, you have a disease or you don't. We wanted to look at quantitative traits that are longitudinal because it gave us a lot more power. We were interested in this gene-environment interaction, and we wanted to come somewhere midway between these studies that had very, very dense information on a few people and very, very scant information on masses of people. And so that led us to sort of some of the conceptual frameworks and the things that underpinned the study as we designed it, which was that we wanted to focus on healthy aging, that we really wanted to take a life course approach, that we really understood that we needed to have good information on the determinants of health, and also that we wanted to come at it from the micro to the macro level. So we really wanted to come at it from the level of the cell to the individual in their community, in broader society, and understand the impact of that. you know, gene and environment interactions are very important, and then we also wanted to capture the dynamic and changing face of Canadians. And the other thing that was clear is that we wanted a research design and a study that would be useful not just for the generation of new information and the, you know, the formulation of new science, but we really wanted to be able to have an impact on policy as well. And so that led us to think about the type of design and how we might approach this. And so that leads us into the CLSA, and so our aims are to look at aging as a dynamic process, to look at the multifaceted interrelationships among both intrinsic and extrinsic factors from midlife to older age, to be able to try and capture some of these trajectories and profiles of aging and understand where critical periods are and how things divert over time. And then as part of the funding, there is the notion that a study of this large cannot simply be even for one large team of investigators. It's a national resource. And so we have formulated it as... although we have our own research questions, it's also been formulated as a platform so that Canadian researchers can use this data and answer multiple research questions and also use it for decision making. So this is what the actual design looks like. We have entered 50,000 men and women who are 45 to 85 at baseline. And they are randomly selected in two ways. So there's one group which we call the tracking group, and those are 20,000 who are randomly selected from across the provinces. And they are followed by phone. And then we have another group which we call the comprehensive, and those are 30,000. And they're randomly selected from within sites. There's 11 sites across the country. They're in 7 provinces. And anybody who's within generally a 25-kilometer radius, but sometimes we've had to expand it in smaller communities to a 50K radius in 7 provinces. And we go into their homes and we interview them in their homes, and then we have them come to a data collection site where they provide an extensive battery of tests. And they also have the option of providing blood and urine. We intend to follow them for 20 years. We go back to them every 3 years for a full rework, and we contact them in between just to maintain contact. And then the intent is that we will link them to their information to other databases over time. So if you look, that dark green bar where there's the questionnaire, that information is consistent across all $50,000 people. We can pool that information together, but then we have additional information on the 30,000. This just gives you an idea of the fact that it's both national and scope, and they're randomly selected. And you can see the actual sites where the data collection sites are located. I'm not going to spend any time on the actual information that's in the CLSA because I know that Heather's going to do this. But you can see that there's a broad range of information in terms of demographics, health behaviors, health status, physical health, psychological health, social health. It really runs the gamut. And then when people come into the data collection site, again, there's a lot of physical and clinical assessment that occurs here. So blood pressure, spirometry, we measure carotid intimal medial thickness, we measure bone mineral density, body composition, and aortic calcification using DEXA. We have information. We do visual acuity and hearing and grip strength, and we also do a neuropsych battery. So there's a lot of information that we have on people, as well as a number of performance measures. The interesting thing about the CLSA is that it's completely standardized. So every single site across the country follows the exact same protocol. It's done fully computerized so that all the data goes right into the computer right as it's being taken, even the clinical assessments, and it gets sent directly to McMaster. And at McMaster, where we have the national coordinating site, the data is cleaned, and then it goes on to the Statistical Analysis Center, which is at McGill. For those who have had their blood and urine taken, it gets stored at a biorepository center, and we ship it out weekly. We do a lot of processing at the actual site to prepare the specimens, but then they're all stored for future use. So one of the key strategies that we have with the CLSA is linking to various other databases. Our priority is to link to health databases because we have a lot of information, and we also have health card numbers, so we can directly link to physician billing data, to mortality data, all of those kinds of things. But there's huge potential to link to other databases as well. And we're one of the strategies when we were doing this, designing the CLSA, is there's only so much information or so much time, so much burden you can place on an individual. And we were really thinking seriously, okay, so what is the information that's out there that we can get on people that we don't have to collect directly from them or that they couldn't provide us with very easily? So there's a lot of things like, you know, climate data and pollution data and land use data and all kinds of things like that, climate data, that we will eventually be able to link with the CLSA. This just gives you an idea of the actual provincial administrative health databases that we intend to link to. This looks like it might be easy, but it's actually a huge challenge because these databases are all under provincial jurisdiction, with the exception of hospital discharge. So we've been working with data stewards and privacy commissioners from across all of the provinces to figure out how we might be able to do this in a national way. But at the moment, the only way to do it is by individual province. One of the things that we have done is that this is an observational study. It's an epidemiologic study. We do not use clinicians or physicians or anything like that. We use trained interviewers to collect all of the information. And one of the challenges is to develop disease outcomes, because obviously, even though it's not a focus, it's something that we clearly want to have good information on. So we've spent a lot of time developing and validating disease algorithms, and you can see this one is for chronic airflow obstruction, but it's quite complicated. But we have a huge amount of information that we can pull together and be pretty confident about a disease outcome. This is a new addition with the next wave of funding. Is that so what we had funding for in the original first wave of the study was to simply collect and store the information, and that includes the biological information as well. But as part of the second wave, we have some funding for a basic biomarker and epigenetic analysis. So at the data collection sites, we do a complete blood cell count on everyone, and that's available now. But we have about 10 proposed biomarkers that will be analyzed on all 30,000, and that's really important because that's data that will then be available for use. We are going to do some genotyping using the UK Biobank assay on 10,000 people, and then we'll be doing some epigenetic analyses with Mike at the UBC Center. And again, all of this will be put back into the database. What I thought you might be interested in is this is actually what the tracking cohort, so that 20,000, we now have complete data on all 20,000 for baseline, and this is where they're actually geographically located. And the reason we can pinpoint them is because they've all been geocoded, because we have their postal code. So that's really important information. And I'm showing you this because, as I said, this is a resource for Canadian researchers, actually for international researchers, but we haven't quite worked that out yet. But you can access the data. This is the data preview portal where you can go in and you can, all of the information that you need to access the data is there. And you can also sign in as a researcher and get basic, very basic proportions, for example, of people who've filled out specific questions. But the intent is that it is for use by the Canadian population. So that's that. One thing that I thought I would do in the last couple of minutes is just give you an example of how this data has been used in a way that I think we might use it here or how we might move forward. So we really didn't have, when we designed the CLSA, as I said before, very much information on the physical environment. And there were a number of people at Health Canada who were very interested in the physical environment and health in older adults. And so what Health Canada did is they pulled together a working group of national experts who were interested in environmental health, and they commissioned a report. And I co-chaired this committee, and we ended up creating this report, and the group identified three priority areas. So they were health effects and exposure to air pollutants, legacy and emerging contaminants, and then metals and other neurotoxicants. And so from there, we worked with Health Canada to develop a proposal, and it was around the first priority that was identified, which was ambient air pollution. And we developed a proposal to do this, and we submitted it to Health Canada. And as a result of funding from that, we're getting some various measures on air pollution from external sources that can then be put into the CLSA database. So in particular, there's satellite-derived observations of mean annual estimates of fine particulate that are geomapped to spatial location. There's ground-based area monitoring from 300 monitoring stations in approximately 200 communities, and they have all of these various features. And then there's another piece of this study where they're measuring the proximity to roadways. And they're getting the total length of roadways within 200 meter radius, and again using GIS software. So those are the kinds of things that actually would be interesting to the kinds of things that we're talking about in the built environment, but it's also an example of how you kind of move forward and then add to the information that's in the CLSA to create greater value. So this is just an overview of some of the variables and some of the content that would be interesting within the CLSA to look at, for example, aging in place, from the level of the cell to the individual to the community and then to the society. And then I just put up this diagram. This comes from a paper by Russo, but I think that the diagram actually came from something that Larry had originally developed. But what it, and it was developed using the ICF classification, and so it focuses on pathology and impairments and functional limitations and disability, and it talks about individual factors, but I think you can actually broaden that to consider the full range of ability or mobility or whatever. And then there's these built environment pieces on top that have this interplay. And so we have the information at the level of the individual, and now we have all of these larger contextual level pieces that we can then use. And I think it absolutely enriches what we can do. So I leave you here with the website. It's clsa-elcv.ca. There's a vast amount of information on the website, and it's hopefully very useful. And you can see that we have recruited to date over 42,000 participants. We're still in the first wave of data collection. It will take us until mid-2015 before we have all of the comprehensive participants recruited. But we do have, and we have released the data on the tracking cohort now. So I just want to acknowledge all of the enabling unit leads. These are the funders of the CLSA. And obviously, we would be nowhere without our participants. And these are actually the very first two participants in the CLSA. Thanks.
So, I'm Heather Stewart, and I'm actually not the data collection site lead for CLSA. I'm actually the operations manager for the two sites that we have in Metro Vancouver. At SFU Surrey and the University of BC.
We actually have Teresa Liu Ambrose here this morning, and Teresa is one of the co-leads for the University of British Columbia data collection site. So she'll be speaking to us, I think, later this morning. Yeah. Okay, so as I just mentioned, Metro Vancouver actually is in a fairly unique situation with the CLSA because we have two of these data collection sites within a stone throw of each other, about 50 kilometers apart. But these two sites are collecting data on the comprehensive cohort only. And they operate in tandem, meaning that they're never operational at the same time. We've actually finished cycle one or wave one of data collection at SFU in Surrey last December, and we saw 1,500 people approximately at that site. And then we started up in January at the UBC site, recruiting another 1,500 people from within about 25 kilometers of this address in Point Grey. And we should be wrapping up cycle one there at the end of March next year. And so these two sets of state-of-the-art infrastructure are essentially free for an 18-month period every 3 years. And so I think we have to really think about that in planning going forward with any new research. Like I said, that's not the situation anywhere else in Canada. Those data collection sites are always operational with CLSA core data collection. So the CLSA data collection sites are designed to be highly standardized, all 11 of them. They're essentially the same structure, same size, same number of rooms, obviously the same installation of equipment and IT infrastructure to produce state-of-the-art, high-quality, highly standardized data across all data collection sites. The infrastructure, the equipment itself is all state-of-the-art. Very easy to learn and operate, and facilitates direct transfer of data from the instrument, whether it's the bone scanner or the spirometer, directly to the computer and then into the data management CLSA servers through a virtual private network. So this reduces transcription errors, reduces time and burden on the research staff, and they were built and designed to be hopefully sustainable for the full 20-year life of the project. So this is just a blueprint of the site at SFU. It's a fairly strange shape, but it's a very contemporary building. And I thought I would mention something about the eligibility criteria for people who may not be familiar. The participants must be between the ages of 45 and 85 at baseline, although they can have turned 65 within about 6 months of their first interview. They need to be fluent in English and French. They must be living in the community or transitional housing. They have to be able to provide informed consent at the baseline interview. And at wave one, at baseline, the comprehensive participants must be able to come to the data collection site for testing. So they must be mobile enough to be able to come to the university or wherever the data collection site is located for that first set of baseline physical tests. Exclusion criteria include people living in the three territories, living on federal First Nations reserves, people who are full-time Canadian Armed Forces members, those who are in long-term care or institutionalized at baseline, and of course people who would be deemed to be cognitively impaired, unable to understand the principles of CLSA and the consent. So Susan flashed you this slide, which has a lot of information on it, and this is really the measures that are the data that's captured by way of the questionnaire modules. And I'm going to review in a little bit more depth some of those measures from the physical, psychological, and social modules of CLSA. In terms of the physical functioning measures, there is a very large table of these measures. It was too much to put on one slide, so I've split it in two. This is the first half of that table. And so it's split and shows you what measures are done in the comprehensive cohort and what ones are done in the tracking cohort. And Q just means that that data is collected by a questionnaire. And you can see for these particular measures, there's a lot of overlap between the comprehensive and the tracking. All but life space index, which I'm not so sure about, Susan, but maybe you can explain that at some point, why that's not being collected in the tracking. And this is part two of the table of physical functioning measures. And you can see that there's now less overlap and that quite a lot of these measures are collected by way of a physical exam on the comprehensive cohort. And so we're going to dig a little deeper into some of these variables. This is just a snapshot of the... it's a web-based tool called Onyx that we use at the data collection sites to manage these long assessments, these interviews when the participants come in. Those assessments take anywhere from about 2.5 to 3 hours to complete. And so Onyx is it's a tool by which when you enter data from, say, the first this contraindication survey here, you have to complete that survey before any of the other stages in the interview will be ready and allow you to continue. And so it's just a way of managing these long assessments, making sure that they're done in the right order with the right preceding information. You can also see here at the top that there's a stage called proxy consent. So participants who are age 70 years of age or older are given the option to identify a proxy at baseline. And I would imagine that they're offered that, that option any time during the study. So to name a proxy and an informant who would help them with ongoing consent in future if they became unable to do so. Someone who would provide ongoing consent, but someone who would also help provide answers to survey questions as well. Okay, so we begin with some simple anthropometric measures. We measure standing height, seated height, weight, etc., hip circumference, waist circumference, and those measures are used to calculate BMI and waist-to-hip ratio. We do a simple vital signs assessment with a machine, actually, that will automatically record 6 blood pressure measurements. For example, take the average of 5 of them, and it just makes for somewhat more accurate recordings. We don't have to have a skilled nurse who's to inflate the cuff and use a stethoscope. It's just a simpler method and is quite reliable. Next, we move on and we perform a 12-lead ECG. Again, it's a very nice instrument. There's minimal skin prep involved. It's essentially one-touch operation. Provides information on the heart rhythm and rate, heart muscle perfusion, whether there's any chamber enlargements or conduction abnormalities. I should also mention at this time that at the end of the participants' visits with us, they're given a 2-page report with about 2/3 of their study results from that particular visit. We can't give them everything back. For example, the ECG, that needs to be interpreted and scored at some point offline. We don't generate that result immediately on site, so we can't give them back those results. We're using a carotid Doppler ultrasound, a Vivid Eye. It's a portable machine from GE Healthcare, which measures primary quantitative traits of circulatory function that are useful to predict individual cardiovascular risk. So we measure carotid intima media thickness, arterial stiffness, and plaque location and volume. And so this is just a single frame, a snapshot of an ultrasound of a common carotid artery. And I think, can you see the pointer? No, you, oh, yes. Yeah, there. So just to orient you, this is the common carotid artery here. This is the internal jugular vein. This is the back of the participant and the front of their neck up here. Their head is up here. Their feet are down at that end. And this is the carotid artery bifurcation, so that the chin is about here, chin level. And so beyond that, the common carotid artery is going to split into the internal and external carotids. And this is an area of primary interest in this study, because it's where the change in the structural properties of the vessel begin, where flow of blood can become turbulent. And if there's going to be any problems with clotting or plaque breaking off, it's probably going to happen here. So we focus a lot of interest in this area. And we record a little movie over three full heart cycles. You can see the ECG tracing down here. And what we'll do with that, we'll choose a frame at end diastole, so when the heart is in its relaxed state and there's not a big bolus of blood going through the vessel, so when the vessel is as relaxed as possible. And we measure the intima media thickness, the thickness of that layer of the artery wall. And so we measure this thickness over about a 1.5 centimeter length at 500 points along that length, and calculate the average intima media thickness. In this case, it's about 0.5 millimeter, which is within the normal range. I think anything above about 0.9 millimeters would be considered to be abnormal. That person would be at risk possibly of a stroke. And with the ultrasound, we also do a plaque sweep. This is not a CLSA image. I borrowed this from the internet. But shows you two views, a transverse section of the common carotid artery. And again, this would probably be just distal to that bifurcation where it starts to widen out and about to split. And you can see some plaque here on the posterior wall of the artery. And also in longitudinal view here, you can see there's some plaque right there. Not necessarily totally occluding the artery, but it's there nevertheless. Oops. Okay. So from there we move on. We do some lung function testing, spirometry. And this is, it's a PC-based tool, very nice. It's a handheld transducer. A device that people blow in through a mouthpiece that records airflow, and it just plugs into the back of the computer. Transducer tells us about flow and volumes. And the measures of interest with spirometry are the forced vital capacity, so that's the maximal volume of air that the participant could inhale into their lungs and blow out in one effort. So it's essentially total lung capacity, except for residual volume. We're also interested in the volume of air that the participant can blow out in the first second of that blowing effort. So usually that they're blowing, pushing for about 6 or 8 seconds. But you should be able to blow out at least 70% of your lung volume in the first second if your airways are healthy, and if your accessory respiratory muscles that help you push that air out are working well. And we'll also be looking, I think, or be interested in the peak expiratory flow rates as well. And all of the data collection sites are equipped with these dual energy X-ray absorptometry machines, or DEXA machines, that are used for a variety of purposes in the CLSA. So we all have Hologic Discovery A machines, the state of the art. And they're nice because the participant lays here. Again, we're not seeing the there. participant lays here on the table, the X-ray source is down here underneath the bed, and this is sort of the sensor here. So as the X-ray passes through tissue, there's a reading made up here. And this is a rotational arm, so rather than if we want to do a side-to-side or lateral view of somebody, we don't have to turn them on their side. This arm will rotate around. So this is an ideal type of instrument for an older population. So regarding bone mineral density, this is one of the quantitative traits that we'd be interested along with strength as they relate to musculoskeletal function and aging. And bone mineral density is reported in terms of a T-score. And a T-score is really the number of standard deviations above or below the mean for a healthy 30-year-old adult of the same sex and ethnicity as the patient or the participant. And so T-scores of minus 1 to minus 2.5 standard deviations would be considered in the range of low or osteopenic, not osteoporotic, but on the low side and at increased risk for fracture. And then T-scores that are minus 2.5 standard deviations or below the mean for a 30-year-old would put someone in the osteoporosis category. And so in this particular scan, which I believe is, it was a volunteer of ours. My pointer here. They have a total T-score for the whole skeleton of minus 0.7, so it's within the normal range. So we scan both hips. And this is an example from a 56-year-old male. The hip scans are analyzed in regions or sections. And the main regions of interest are here, which is the femoral neck. And also this area here from this, it's called the greater trochanter, down to this protuberance, which is the lesser trochanter, the intertrochanteric line. Those are the two main regions of interest, because if someone is going to fracture their hip, it's often in those areas. And so in this particular scan, the neck femoral neck T-score was minus 1.9. So again, that puts them at the increased risk category for fracture. And the intertrochanteric region, the T-score was still within the normal range at minus 0.5. And we also do a lateral spine scan of the lumbar and the lower thoracic spine. And with these scans, of course, we can look at the vertebral and intervertebral dimensions, how tall are the vertebrae, is that within the normal range for age. But we can also look at abdominal aortic calcifications, because we should be able to see in these scans the descending abdominal aorta just anterior to the vertebral column. And this is not a CLSA scan, but it is an example of one that shows these calcifications in the abdominal aorta at the anterior edge of the vessel and then at the posterior margin of the vessel as well. And so CLSA will be looking at looking for abdominal aortic calcification as well in our participants. And then finally, we use the DEXA for body composition analysis. So in this particular image, bone is indicated by sort of the blue tones, okay, skeleton calcified material. Lean tissue is represented in the red and pink colors. And adipose tissue would be more orange to yellow colors. I think participants always get a kick out of seeing this particular image, although we don't give it back to them in the report. So you can just tell by looking at this image that this is a fairly lean individual. They really aren't displaying much in the way of fat. And in fact, they are at the 45th percentile compared to they're in the 11th percentile for age matched, so they're very lean. Compared to young normals, they're sort of in the 45th percentile, and I think this person is about 56 years old. And this is just another image. I think this is a series from the same individual. Again, this is not CLSA, but it's just to demonstrate. Looks like somebody who took it upon themselves to lose a little bit of body fat over a six-month period. So it's a nice demonstration of the capacity for the DEXA machine to capture these changes over time. Okay, in terms of mobility measures, we do quite a few of them, including a timed up-and-go test where the individual is sitting down in a chair. They are asked to stand up. They can use the armrests if they need to. They stand up. They walk 3 meters this way, cross a line, turn around, walk back, cross that line, sit back down in the chair, and we time that. Okay? Is that 2 minutes? Okay. We also do a 4 meter walk test as well. So again, this is just walking at your regular pace, 4 meters, usually in the hallway of the data collection site, and it's timed, and participants can use any aids. They require canes or walkers to perform those tests. And these are well-standardized measures. They're quite reliable. They're known to be sensitive to changes in mobility in older adults. And they have good inter-rater reliability as well. We perform a chair rise test where the participant needs to stand up from a seated position 5 times. That measures a lot of muscular strength, the combined muscular strength, proximal, distal, et cetera, and balance. And then we do a standing balance test. They have to stand on each leg separately and try to stay there for 60 seconds. It's rather challenging without shoes on. We measure hand grip strength, which is it's a good surrogate for overall skeletal muscle strength. And we test the dominant hand in a very standardized way, same positioning that most other studies of aging have used. We test people's hearing at 8 different frequencies, both ears. We don't have soundproof booths in the data collection sites, but we use a technology that is pretty good at being able to cancel out external noise. We assess people's vision, visual acuity, but also we measure intraocular pressures. Am I done? Okay. And Also, we look at the backs of people's eyes, so we do digital retinal imaging where we can see the macula, we can see the optic nerve and the vasculature in the retina, useful for identifying diabetic retinopathy, complications related to other vascular complications related to diabetes, etc. And this is just an image that shows early macular degeneration here with the drusen over the macula. Vision can be normal at this particular stage. And there are a number of questionnaire-based measures of physical functioning as well, on functional status, ADLs and IADLs, life space index, general health, injuries, falls, oral health, women's health, pain and discomfort, vision, hearing, weight and height, healthcare utilization, medication use. With a comprehensive, we capture information directly from the medication labels, from the DIN numbers and other medication on the actual bottle labels, what kind of supplements they use, their sleep, and chronic conditions. I'll just skip over this, I think. So in terms of psychological functioning, the CLSA uses several instruments to measure four domains of psychological functioning. So cognition, comprising memory, executive function, psychomotor speed, mood, psychopathology, and personality traits, including openness, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, neuroticism. So there are a core set of neuropsychological measures between the comprehensive and tracking cohorts. Or these are measures that can be administered either face-to-face or over the telephone. They can be done both ways. And then there are some neuropsychological tests that are administered face-to-face with the comprehensive participants in the data collection site. So including event-based prospective memory testing, Stroop neurological testing. Perhaps some of you have done that test before. Oral word association tests. How many words can you say in a minute beginning with FAS? Choice reaction time, so psychomotor speed. And a time-based prospective memory test as well. So these are tests where the participant's giving some instruction, needing to watch a clock, giving a task to do when the clock reaches a certain time, those types of memory tests. And in terms of social functioning, sorry, Larry, I will just try to go quickly. So we're interested in what the CLSA includes now in terms of measures of that are relevant to the built environment, transportation, etc. So on the maintaining contact survey, which happens 18 months after their first visit to the data collection site, and this survey is available on the CLSA website, I just wanted to review some of the data that is captured with this particular survey. So regarding transportation mobility, there's some questions about driving status and frequency, self-rating of driving skills, safety and avoidance behaviors, types and frequency of transportation used in the last year and month, and barriers to use of public transportation. What do they perceive to be barriers? And regarding the built environment, there are questions about housing satisfaction, self-reported problems with housing. Does their roof leak? Is it drafty? Is their home drafty, etc.? And then some questions about the perception of their neighborhood, safety, how supportive is the neighborhood in which they live, cleanliness, and inclusiveness. Susan, I don't know if you mentioned, well, you did. You mentioned that CLSA doesn't include clinicians to do physical exams to ascertain disease outcomes. And so we use disease algorithms to compute these outcomes. So using survey data, some of the blood work, medication use, etc., to compute algorithms on diabetes, cerebrovascular disease, thyroid disease, etc., etc. There are 12 altogether. And then the classifications or the outcomes that result are diseased, not diseased, probably or possibly diseased, or uncertain. I don't know if I have time to go into this, Larry. No? Okay. Is that a yes or no?
No.
Okay. All right. Actually, this afternoon, we'll probably be talking about blood and the biological samples a little bit more with Mike in the biomarkers group, focus group. And Mike will probably speak a little bit more about this as well. Okay, so I'm going to pass it over to Larry.
Thank you, Heather. That was great. So everybody can see the comprehensiveness, the level of detail, and then be, I'm sure, thinking about some of the pathways that would connect us from the built environment through to certain outcomes that are logical and measurable and tractable. I was thinking of a couple, certainly with air pollution exposure. and physical functioning, and then with physical activity, you then have a cardiovascular connection. One is positive, one could be negative, and that's a big research question for us. Increased walkability is positively correlated with exposure to air pollution, which I'm about to show. But just in reflection, looking at all the detail, I was looking at Heather's map of the location of fatty tissue, and asked Brian, who works on this, central adiposity, and one of the research questions is not just BMI and body weight, but it's the location of fat, and thinking about over the life course, as you're tracking someone and building up this measure of exposure to place in different kinds of places, it seems like there's lots of potential. So I think as we're starting to move into the afternoons and thinking about what the data gaps are, what the plausible pathways are to connect built environment through to healthy aging outcomes, and then metrics, which is the purpose of the three breakout sessions in sequence, you know, be thinking about, and that was the idea to just give you kind of a flavor of the CLSA, which captures so many different things. It's pretty interesting to follow a talk that goes into the level of detail, which is at the extent that Heather went into with mapping. I'm actually a CLSA participant. I now know my visual acuity, and apparently, I guess it's pretty good. I can see really well. Just sort of thinking about all the information, and I was also wondering, I actually did not want to have Heather stop, but I'm now down to like 20, 25 minutes, and I had a 45 minute, I had a 30 minute talk like the others. I banked 15 minutes, which I thought I knew would happen, and I don't want to make it so that we're too far off agenda, so I've got about 25 minutes left. Can you inform participants if you see a problem, like the ischemic artery? I was thinking, well, gosh, what if someone comes in, they've got a problem, and then you have 50,000 participants, so if a percentage of them you see this, you're biasing the results, because these people then get, hey, you need to do something about that carotid artery, or you're going to keel over. You know, it's like, I just think, is that informing them when you see? I just thought, what a research dilemma, because it could screw up the results, but it makes someone live. Anyways, so I don't know. I just came up in my mind. So anyways, I like to use this metaphor a lot. Came up with this a while ago with wonderful colleagues that I get to work with. Built environment, you know, everything rests, because I think you can predict the likelihood that people have hair color that's of unusual hues based on walkability. You think about it, people in more walkable places are probably more liberal, and they're more likely to have wild hair color. So we can predict everything, with almost a lot of things with walkability. But anyways, we can, you know, talk about built environment, behavior, environmental quality, and then mental and physical well-being in all connection. And, you know, we're really interested in our workshop broadening back out. Wanted you to have that background of detail. What is a CLSA? But more importantly, the workshop is more about thinking about how we age. There's other really interesting data sets as well. I was wondering about the LIFE-P study, the LIFE study that Abby works on, and wondering, you know, in the U.S., it's a similar kind of, it gets blood work and data. I was wondering, do we have all this kind of data in LIFE? Probably do, and done maybe similar, maybe differently. Each one has different strengths, but really to look at the interplay between built and actually just backing up a second, how the two countries can actually work together was really a main theme for me today. And seeing all the expertise on both sides of the border, we each have different things we're working on, and we learn from each other this way. So this exchange is important. And then really to look at how this evidence interplay between built environment features, including transportation infrastructure, land use patterns affect our aging process. Gaps, I mentioned, causal pathways, moderating and mediating mechanisms as part of those pathways. Physical functioning would mediate the relationship between physical activity expressed and built environment. So one of the breakout groups is actually a mediator or moderator or effect modifier to the other. So it's sort of that's going to come together at the end of the event when we take the groups and put you all together. And then we need to map out key dependent and independent indicators of the four domains and to facilitate the collaboration amongst you all. So one of the things that inspired the workshop is that when I learned more about CLSA and looking at the life study in the U.S., which is a cohort as well, and other longitudinal studies working with Rick on the study in Seattle where they've got, you know, years, decades of data on people, is that data is being collected all the time on people, and spatializing people into the spatial context is actually somewhat easy. It can be, but knowing what to measure and building those measures in the right way so that you're actually going to find something that you're looking for is really complex. And so that's where I thought, what an opportunity there is. And then the vision is that significant shifts in transportation, now more the policy stuff. And we have intentionally invited today people working in local government, you've heard, at different levels of government, at the provincial, at national, and different roles and responsibilities. We've got really UBC is now taking on well-being as an organizing principle and initiative. Matt Dolph, who walked in recently, is from UBC and is our lead from Vancouver campus. So this is really elevating, and the relationship between the university and the region is becoming paramount. Our new president has made that one of the key messages for our university, and others are doing similar things. So basically, we're seeing significant the need for significant shifts in funding priorities is going to be required in support of land use actions, and we'll need to document healthcare cost savings. Dale, who is not speaking today, but has said this many times very clearly, as soon as I remember we had our first research event, you immediately said to the health authority, it was actually the provincial healthcare lead in our event, if we're going to invest in active transportation to save money for healthcare dollars, you guys should be helping pay for this stuff. And it, you know, so how can that happen? We need the healthcare sector to help underwrite or be able to mobilize resources that could be projected savings into underwriting walkability. And that's really where we want to go. So that's really the promise in this. But in order to do that, we need the stronger connection between evidence and decision making. So bigger picture stuff. I think Susan talked about this, and in the interest of time, I'll skip it. But basically, that's the well-being focus. And that's why I personally wanted to work on the mental health and cognition part workshop. Interested in all of it and how the tracking and having the data that is not evidenced, expressed manifest disease, but the biomarker information that Heather showed really clearly is so important. I'm going to make a couple additions here, though. Really, wellness, mental, physical, and spiritual, but that clearly we've been measuring walkability a little too much. I mean, we do work on green space and access to nature, playability, but there's clear evidence on healthy aging and the importance of green space and physical activity and really social capital and how those pieces all fit together. So this is a kind of a framework we use a lot in our work, but the built environment, lots of interplay between just over here. When we build certain infrastructure, we get development response. So if you build a certain kind of transportation system, transit, more walkable pedestrian infrastructure, developers will react and provide a certain kind of development pattern that's more walkable. So there's a lot of interaction between, and it goes the other way too. Transportation agencies argue all we're doing is trying to keep up with the growth, the sprawl that you're building, so we have to build more highways, which is a very actually weak politically common response, but it is prevalent. And so what we have to do now is use the kind of evidence that we're going to build together and that we already are working on creating to actually create a performance-based approach to transportation funding, where actually all this evidence on built environment, its effect tied to these health outcomes, gets used to say, if you build in this way, we will then provide transportation dollars for you. And this is a huge political issue, is that the province will say, and TransLink to an extent less so, that's our regional, we think state, provincial, and federal as well, is that land use and the decisions that are made on the ground are local government, they're municipal. We don't really get in that game. In fact, we can't. We don't have that authority. But in reality, you do. And it's just saying you're going to take the political bite there and say, this is the money we have, and here's the regional growth strategy, and we're going to operationalize these goals in a way that has a health partly health and well-being and environmental sustainability focus. And when you do that, you can prioritize how you're going to get to your goals, which state we want healthy communities. Well, if you want that, here's what the evidence shows gets you that. And this is what we have to do with our money to get there. So we're just going to allocate dollars on this performance criteria and track over time these metrics. It's not like we can't figure out how to do that. It's a political question. But as researchers, we can push that political agenda. And we never get our way the first time or second time, but we create accountability through the evidence. So when it happens and the health problems occur and all the environmental, then you can point, you knew it, and now we can make that case. And it becomes a legal battle, is what it is. And it will be a Supreme Court case in the U.S., zoning. Zoning is how we legally determine how land is used, is premised on health, safety, and welfare. And we have legal arguments, we have evidence now to show that the way you use land needs to support public health. Mixed use, having density, these things are required in order for shops and services to support parks and infrastructure and all the amenities that make healthy aging possible. So we know that, and we're going to end up in a legal court case at a Supreme Court level on this issue for sure in both countries before things will really change. But it will happen, and it takes time. You need the evidence to do it. So built environment, travel behavior, the pathways move forward, their behavior and their exposure, they interact. We're going to be talking about those mechanisms today. And then the health outcomes and getting at the cost, which is obviously really fundamental. Everybody knows one of these images. We can't do this workshop without an image like that. But basically, observation specific, the hallmark of the research is really ecologically based. We need to know what people can and can't get to. And so this 1 kilometer, whether it's whatever kind of buffer we use around the CLSA or any other participants, we need to know what kind of destinations are within that walkable buffer and how far someone can actually get to and their domain and if transit's there and the quality of it and all that. In Vancouver, like other regions, we measure it across the surface of our region. And others do it as well in similar ways, and we end up with ways to rank places. These are 3 different communities in our region. We typically measure walkability in a number of ways, but since not everybody is familiar with it, I'll just explain. Density, dwelling units per acre, a metric most people, everybody I think pretty well gets that. This is commercial density. So these are 3 different neighborhoods. Ambleside, which is kind of a medium, you can look at the overall walkability score. It's kind of a residential community of moderate density. You can see then we have commercial density, intersection density, and land use mix. This is the ratio of square footage of building to land area. And when you have a higher retail floor area ratio, you have buildings up to the street so that there's not a sea of parking in front. In suburbia, it's low, and in a walkable town center, you're walking along the street, and the shop is right there next to the curb, or next to the sidewalk, and it actually fills that building envelope. It is more walkable. We see people walk more in those kinds of environments. Intersection density is having a connected street grid, so you can travel through the network directly, and then land use mix is having shops and services nearby, so we roll those up into an index. When we take that walkability index, though, and we cross-reference it with air pollution exposure, as Julian Marshall, Mike Brower, and I did in 2008, we say that we've got a bit of an issue. The more walkable places in our region have higher concentrations near roadway edge of small particulates. This is a serious problem for healthy aging. Those blood small particulates can pass the blood-brain barrier. Many of you are researchers, experts in this topic, understand that critical importance. So new templates for ways to design communities so that we have some setbacks. Healthier aging will require that certain locations where we have goods movement necessary for our economy has to happen. The Knight Street corridor in our region here is where trucks go from the port to get onto the railroad and get across Canada. So basically a big issue for us is very bad exposure to air pollution. And there are very different kinds of pollutants. We have NO, which was used here, is a marker for small particulates. Ozone's the opposite. We don't have a problem with ozone relative to roadway edge. Ozone is a regional issue. It does affect seniors. It affects all of us, though. Particulates are really bad for seniors. And so this is a big issue we have. The good news is, you can see, so red are our areas that are not walkable, have high particulate concentration, and also high ozone. Look at where they are. So that's where you got this cross-referencing of walkability and air pollution exposure. And then the greens are all up here in Vancouver. So if we sold real estate based on this map, it looks like we are selling real estate based on that map. In fact, ironically, that's land value right there. And actually, the prevailing winds come off the Pacific. So we can actually have all kinds of local climatic conditions that affect this, but it's quite interesting, and it affects health. So lots of studies have been done. Betsy, who will speak this afternoon, has been really helpful with us, has been working doing a systematic review for looking at longitudinal studies and healthy aging. When we wrote the proposal for the workshop, we had this one reference, and I just pulled it. But 8 longitudinal studies, all but 3 of them found positive associations. But social determinants were found to be a key aspect of healthy aging. But they're basically not measuring built environment, was more or less. We need an understanding that it's important. Beard and Petito identified 51 studies, 18 longitudinal, quite a bit. But the need for longitudinal research and neighborhood features not included. It's really a wide open field at this point. There's not been a lot done longitudinally. A lot of cross-sectional evidence. I'm going to mention some. A study we wrapped up a few years ago, Abby worked on it with me, with Jacqueline Kerr and Dori Rosenberg, and basically increased walkability. So we do know from cross-sectional evidence pretty clear relationships exist, which make plausible the investigation of causation. Walkability related with more walking, time spent traveling in a car, and lower odds of being overweight. Those with one or no cars, more likely to walk and spend less time in cars, but also less likely to get recommended physical activity levels. So that's a confounding issue for us, access to cars. In an automobile-dependent urban form, increases the likelihood people will be active. They're going to also be more active in the first place to be able to drive. So you have to look and control for that effect, because you're talking about more able-bodied people in the first place. Visiting a fast food outlet was associated with increased odds of obesity. So similar results. Just wanted to mention that. And then I'm going to go in quickly. I can't help but to show some new evidence. We just finished yesterday. This is one of the largest data sets. This is taking a health prevalence data set, which is the state of California's health interview survey, a sample of 40,000 people. And we took the California Household Travel Survey, both 2011 new data sets, with 50,000 people, 54,000, and we mapped them and looked at the built environment relationships with a variety of health outcomes. So this is brand new. We're building a software tool to predict health outcomes in communities, and I'm going to present the aging population in that survey. And I'm only getting familiar with the results myself, so I'll be interpreting them with you. But I feel comfortable enough to do that because I picked who came. But anyways, you can see the subsamples, about 11,000. That's a lot of people, so powered up pretty well for the health interview survey, and then about 8,500 in the travel survey, and we need both. The travel survey gives us actually where people go and how they get around, and the health survey, of course, gives us the health outcomes. So we make the best use of existing data. So in this study, you can see the things that we measured. So we looked at land use and development patterns using a 150-meter grid cell. We've layered a built environment surface across the state of California in the urbanized area, so it's covering, like, I think 25 million people are impacted by it. So this is a really scaled up thing. It's a bit on steroids. Transportation system characteristics, we know about proximity to roadways, we know about their regional accessibility, travel time by road and distance to transit, and then we know the employment type and amount they work. and we've built a buffer. All these factors are being captured, so we know the density, the commercial density, that FAR measure that I mentioned that captures a pedestrian scale design, mixed use, connectivity of the road network, transit stop density, park acreage, travel time by car and transit, how long it takes to get around your region. Critical to healthy aging and to quality of life is not just the design of the neighborhood we're in, of course, but the travel time it takes. So you can have a walkable area, but you're out at the edge of a region. It doesn't do you a lot of good if you have to spend all your time in a car getting, or anyway, getting around. So that's picked up. And this variable overwhelms everything else in the model. And I've been working really hard with our research collaborations to get other researchers who have bought into walkability for sure to understand this regional accessibility is really important. And it's more powerful than any, think about the, you know, in your own life. So distance to nearest, all these factors, we have also these measures. So a pretty rich data set. Of the descriptives, basically just the mode split. So overall, in the travel survey, which is the upper right box, the mode split is about 10% mode split. So we've got San Francisco folded in with LA and San Diego and Sacramento. So the average comes up about 10% walking. Recreational physical activity, our percent who expressed any was 17. The automobile mode split was about 3/4, 75, and walking for transportation, mean daily minimum, mean daily minutes is 3 to 4, pathetic, but true. And then that's reported, people walk more than they report. And then recreational physical activity, mean daily minutes 18, and automobile travel about an hour. The average person spends an hour in a car there. Percent overweight, 35%, obese, 20, consistent with the national numbers. High blood pressure, about 60%, type 2 diabetes, about 15. I don't know how that relates to statistics in Canada. Is that consistent? Anybody know? 15% type 2? That seems really high. Percent that reported, well, this is seniors. This is only seniors. So there you go. That's what it's supposed to be. Right, so we started looking at these numbers, and you know, basically you can see where there are three pluses, flat out significant, but you just look at the order of magnitude. So any walking for transportation, we expect walkability to predict that, and it does. Rail access increase, regional accessibility, positive, so any walking for transportation, if you have better regional accessibility, you're gonna walk more. Distance to schools goes down. As distance to school is less, you walk more, inverse, and more park access, more walking. So that works. And I was just wondering, I don't have time to present them all, but the minutes of walking were significantly related with the walkability and with park access. And then for recreation, park access, we expect. So body mass index was inversely related to rail access. And roadway distance to roadway edge, this is a very interesting variable. It picks up and captures so many factors, way beyond air pollution and respiratory. We've been talking about that on some of our calls. It's correlated with, we found it correlated with obesity in another data set, and there it is. I think it did. Yep. So then some of the chronic disease, major road access, predicting blood pressure, higher blood pressure. I think Susan presented something that was consistent with that. I don't remember. Maybe I imagined that. But anyway, so blood pressure, problematic, and then type 2 diabetes. These are, obviously, we expect this relationship. Walkability is significant, and then inverse, regional accessibility goes down, is associated with less type 2 diabetes and park access. So there's got to be mechanisms that are connecting these things. We had a study recently released with an 18% reduction in the likelihood of obesity for people for each additional 10% coverage of tree canopy. Well, trees don't necessarily make you thin just by having, you don't plant a tree and lose weight. I mean, I guess maybe. I don't know, if you work really hard planting the tree, you could lose weight, right? But that's not what's going on. It's the physical activity that's associated with a better built environment, because where you have better tree canopy, you have better sidewalks, and you have better street furniture, and you have wealthier people. And so we control for all that, but you never fully control for income. even though you think you do. So this is the last piece on this, is the sensitivity analysis. So the way that these tools work, and just wanted to mention, these can help formulate some hypotheses for CLSA here, is, and this is, you know, just to show, so what we did was we tested our variables, all those measures, by using a one decile in the healthful direction. So we went from the 50th median to the 60th percentile in each variable. So we ratcheted up a modest amount. And we see in the outcomes, let's see if this comes through. I guess the cursor doesn't, okay, maybe it's here. So over here, so we have a percent change. We'll just focus here. So we see a 22% change in minutes of walking for that 10% increase in base case and active. You can kind of look through the numbers here and get a sense that for very modest changes, everything's moving in the expected direction for seniors. Seniors are the most sensitive age group we find with built environment outcomes. Youth as well, but a little bit more unpredictable. Seniors tend to track as we expect, but a little more sensitive. We get stronger relationships with built environment outcomes. Very important for today's workshop, so that we understand kind of going forward. There's a lot of when we pull levers on built environment, we can expect changes to come in expected directions with the elderly population. So what factors, everybody knows walk score, what factors affect seniors' likelihood to walk the most in terms of destinations? A park and some coffee, right? Well, that was Seattle data, so we don't know if it's generalizable, but maybe we'll learn that in CLSA. Different age groups have different distance decay functions. Everybody who works in transportation knows what a distance decay function is, but our behavioral relationship with the design of the places we live in is not linear. We're not going to walk more than five, typically five blocks, I'm done. People are like, you know, but if something's a block away, you may be four times more likely to walk to it. So what this suggests is seniors were moderately sensitive to distance for short walk trips compared to general adults, to the regular adult population, but least sensitive to distance for longer walk trips. And it's because we think, we haven't tested this yet, that they're willing, they have more discretionary time and able to walk further for leisure. And so that's what's mixed in, and so we need to tease that apart. I think I need to wrap up in a couple minutes, so I'm just going to mention an important premise here is clearly through nature, health benefits of nature. I wanted to mention a couple of things. Biophilia, attention restoration theory, nature deficit disorder. We have on the biophilia an instinctive affiliation for and need for connection with the natural world. And through the healthy aging process, it's obvious that that might be even more important in the latter years in life. And I don't think we fully have explored that. And I think this dose of time and place through CLSA and other longitudinal studies may give us some real inference around that and how that may lead to things like cancer development and other things that could come from a lack thereof. Exposure to nature, attention, mental health. The mental health connection and physical activity connections are the really clear, and Betsy will probably speak to that in the afternoon. Lack of exposure to nature associated with behavioral development and physical disorders, more powerful than we realize. I'll skip this just to mention, if you're interested and want more information, we've done some reviews on this topic. Lots of evidence showing the mental health connection that can inform the kind of hypotheses that can be generated, mostly cross-sectional studies to date. Open space, physical activity, really clear connection there. I think everybody gets it. And finally, health districts is an emerging area of work. I've been doing a lot of work with the health authorities, and in the U.S., the onset of the Affordable Care Act, changing the landscape of healthcare service delivery, is coming with really interesting research opportunities. In Vancouver, we happen to have a major piece of land the city is working on, Pearson Dogwood, with the health authorities. The health authority in this case is the developer. They own all the land. So it's really the hospitals and people that own Kaiser Permanente, people that own and operate hospitals. Hospitals are notoriously some of the least healthy environments in our cities. So it's really creating a major kind of like, you guys need to kind of play ball here with us if you want people to get healthy, especially elderly who live nearby or, you know, This is critical stuff. So this is a 29-acre parcel between here. How many took the Canada Line to get from the airport who are visiting to downtown? Anybody take the train? Oh, my God. Anyways, on the way, it's right near where I live. There's this huge piece of underdeveloped land. It's some of the, we put a $2 billion train line underneath Canby Street. This is a really valuable at build-out. It's worth over $500 million. This is, we're talking serious change. And there's a potential train station that would go right next to this development. So the health benefits of proximity to transit and the redevelopment of this piece of land in a health supportive way for healthy aging is really going to be interesting. And there's all of these projects occurring all over North America and around the world, very interesting, with all kinds of design elements such as, you know, that affect active living, things about the pedestrian environment, connections to transit. Brian will be talking in his presenting on a lot of these microscale features and how they map out and relate with some of the health related outcomes, physical activity, open space, and then on the latter part, affordability is really important. We don't have, we just released a study, it's in your folder, an infographic, shows the recent thing we just put out, shows that in Vancouver, as part of the research, and it's really part of CLSA, one of the questions that if when we try to go forward and add anything new, as a CLSA participant, I wonder how much respondent burden there can be. But obviously, an ancillary study requires some information to be collected. And at the top of that would be controlling for self-selection. Why people pick neighborhoods. We need to know that in order to isolate the effect of the design on the outcome. So this is where we did that kind of work, and we found just using it in a different way, 60% of the residents of Vancouver in the city, in the walkable, more walkable city, and 40% of suburban residents strongly desire and prefer a walkable neighborhood. People who prefer and live in walkable neighborhoods report significantly lower high blood pressure, 10%, versus those who prefer but do not live in a walkable neighborhood. We have a market out there wanting to live in a walkable and being able to express healthier behaviors. They can't afford it. We are undersupplying this product. So we have a market argument with the development community. We have a health argument and then an environmental one, all conspiring to really say we need to change lending policies, municipal legislation and governance, and transportation funding priorities to bring the supply up so that the price can go down. So through that, hopefully we'll be able to move forward. I think I'm just going to make a last point on the four breakouts, and I'm done. And then we have a break. So basically, mobility and physical functioning, a core area of research in the aging literature, but poorly connected to date. And you have in the write-up, there's some write-ups in the packets. So I hope if you all had a chance to look at that, with built environment features. Probably maybe the second most connected with built environment to date because, of course, having, you know, smooth sidewalk surfaces and so forth has been measured with mobility, and a lot of you have done research in this area. Mental health and cognition, growing area around wellness with considerable promise, mentioned some of that. Health behaviors, most of you signed up to look at health behaviors. We all study that, and that's our, I think, clearly interesting topic and will continue to be, but it's the most researched area, but not well evaluated yet with mobility, mental health as mediator, moderator, and the microscale features haven't been looked at, the pedestrian environment that are cheaper and easier interventions to make. Finally, the biomarkers, promising emerging area with detection of precursor conditions and capacity to map genome over time in relation to time spent in different environments. So I'll just conclude with one statement that my father always says, that if I knew I was going to live this long, I would have taken better care of myself. Everything Susan said made that really viable. People are living longer, but living well. Thank you. I look forward to a wonderful event with you in the next 2 days. So for the three of us, questions for a few minutes. Any questions anybody has, we'd love to hear, and then we'll have time for a break. And will you introduce yourself? You came
yes,
in after.
I'm Kathy Jameson, and I'm from the Council of Senior Citizens Organization. So I'm interested in your ethical guidelines
two questions, in fact. And the second is how you define well-being, because I've been looking at the literature of child well-being, which is extensive, and I haven't found a good definition. But that could be very quick to my working definition. But first of all, you mentioned that you might be faced with finding somebody, because and seniors do have different conditions that develop at the age, that somebody has a serious issue, health issue. Are you obliged to inform them or not, or does your consent form say that you're not obliged to inform them?
It's a Heather and Susan question.
So it's a very good question. So in the CLSA, part of the issue is that we're an observational study. We collect information, but we don't necessarily analyze information. And there are no clinicians involved. So we make it very clear in the consent form that this is not a study that is a medical study, that we in no way replace their healthcare, and that it's strictly with the responsibility of them and their healthcare provider to look after their medical care. That said, there may, and we can't guarantee that we will find something because, again, we're not technicians, or we're only technicians who collect the data for the most part, and the data gets stored. So we may not recognize it when it comes up, or it may not come up for a very long time. So people have to be aware of that right from the outset. That said, if we do recognize anything that is life-threatening in the sense that if we didn't tell them it would have an impact, we have a whole incidental findings protocol that we follow. So it's complex.
Thank you. Lots of questions. So,
The other point is the information that we do return to people, we return it based on three principles. One is that we have population-associated norms that we can, so that we can provide their information along with reference information. The other is if they took it to a physician, there would be some actionable result that the physician could do with it. And then the third is around feasibility.
Great.
A question for Susan and Heather. Is there any attempt to kind of stratify the samples in order to get a diversity of people? So I'm wondering whether you get enough low-income people, for example, and people of different cultures and races.
That's a very good point. Do you want me to answer that? Yeah. Oh, yeah. So what has happened is people are randomly selected to participate, and we've used a number of different ways, but primarily it's either through using health registry lists with the province, or we do random digit dialing. But what has happened in the tracking cohort and what we're now doing with the comprehensive cohort is we compared it to census data and to CCHS, and what we did find is that we had a lower proportion of people in low SES. So for the last group, we targeted low SES postal codes in which to do our recruitment. And so the tracking cohort is, the maximum number is supposed to be 20,000. We actually have 21,241, and part of that was because we needed to balance SES out a bit. It's really, really difficult. And you have to kind of pick your areas that you're going to try and balance out on. We could not balance out on ethnicity. And the reason we can't balance out on, part of the reason we can't balance out in ethnicity is because you need to be able to understand English or French, because we just don't have the capacity to administer the information in multiple languages.
Chris?
I have a question for you, Larry, which is, the wonderful, very obvious opportunity built into this discussion today for longitudinal research on the impacts of built environment interventions. And so I'm wondering if you and the folks who are at the core of this project are starting to think about what are sort of the pilot projects, either in this region or nationally, that have strong policy implications that you want to be able to test, because you arguably would have enough people in some of these areas to be able to look at if you do put in transit, or if you do a different kind of development, and you know, what sort of changes do we see over time, which overcomes the self-selection?
So that Thanks for asking that, Chris. Actually, even though there's about 6,000 CLSA participants in the Vancouver region, they're distributed so much that we don't. This is not the data set for the intervention type of research that's spatially defined. But if a programmatic intervention came online, like congestion pricing, were implemented in the region, it would be a perfect data set for it. So you got to look for more broad strokes. Has to be something like change, some bigger change would have, you know, vehicle registration, carbon tax, these kind of things, but not a spatially defined intervention. But it's absolutely the right kind of thinking. You're building up exposure over time to place, and it can be used in lots of ways. Absolutely. Other questions? Please.
I'm a planner by profession, so I zero in on your presentation and the issues which you brought up. One of it is when you are investigating the distribution of retail space, are you really looking at vacancy at the given moment? Because you may have whole area designated for retail and nothing gets built. And secondly, walking to McDonald's is not really healthy. So, how are you addressing that issue? And I have another question. Which is related to pollutants.
I can, yeah. Can you remember your third question? Because I've already forgotten the first one. Right. So your first question is, how do we map, how do we measure distance to...
What is your definition of what constitutes positive retail location? Because you used to...
We're objectively, we're not putting a value on it. We're just measuring distances to specific destinations and looking at how that then predicts. We don't even know. We don't want to lay a judgment on. We look at access to opportunities. It's measured based on objective just information of, well, there's perceived distance, and then there's objective measured distance, and then all kinds of destinations. And then we look at how it relates with the behavior to inform us if it's positive or not. Oh, okay, the kind of... No, it's stuff on the ground today. They're present. It's not like it could be built 30 years from now. No, it's actual real data, parcel data used for taxation, and also other types of data sets that have destinations already provided in existence at the same time the survey is done.
And you don't pass any judgment in walking to farmer's market versus going to McDonald's?
The behavioral data that we get informs us if it's good or bad. Right, but we don't judge it as being positive or negative at the beginning.
Okay, and the other question is dealing with the pollutants. They're not only pollutants coming from outside. A lot of chemicals are used for inside of the buildings, and people are breathing.
Absolutely. So just in the interest of time, because I want other, we need to wrap up and let people have a chance to have a break, that air pollution exposure, we're not capturing indoor air pollution in the study. Maybe CLSA could. Possibly. There could be another, sniffers or other ways to objectively collect that, off-gassing of carpet, all that. People spend more time indoors than outdoors, so very good point. And maybe that's another proposal for another operating grant, not ours. Thank you. Thank you so much. So why don't we, maybe we'll have time for, anybody have a burning question before we have a little break? If so, please ask now. Or ask if anybody else has a question. Anybody? Because I think people want to take, and maybe we can take your last question after the break. Can we do that? Oh, go ahead.
The question is very simple. There was one of the components dealing with women health. There was nothing about men. Is the whole study designed for women only?
The CLSA?
Yeah.
No, not at all. It's an example, probably. I'm a CLSA participant, and last time I checked, I was not a woman. Thank you.